Good afternoon, and a very warm welcome to all of you who decided to welcome us here today. My name is Linus Kjellberg, and I'm responsible for sales. Today I'm here at the Bosch Rexroth headquarters, and with me today I have my colleague Halil Ergin. Welcome, Halil. How are you doing today?
Hey, Linus. Thanks. I'm fine. How are you doing?
Very well. We're happy to be here together and to guide you through this session around 40 minutes. We will take a look into Kassow Robots and also possibly answer the question, why are we at the Bosch Rexroth headquarters? But we promise you, it's not going to be a boring session, not just about theory, we're also going to get hands-on later. So we got a little surprise for you lined up. But before we get going into the details, we just want to give you a couple of hints about the platform that we're using. So today we're on the MS Teams platform, and first, and furthermore, this session will be recorded and also made available after the session to make sure that if you want to watch it again, or if you have some colleagues that did not have the chance to join this web seminar today. As you might have noticed, your microphones and cameras are automatically disabled. This means that the chat functionality is the way of communication today. You can find the chat up on your right corner on your screen. So keep that dialogue open and we will interact with you. We will also ask you some questions, and when we do that, you're going to get a pop-up in the middle of your screen. So it's quite prominent. Make sure to look at it and also answer the questions so we can keep a dialogue and it's not just a monologue from our side today. But enough about that. Halil, do you feel comfortable starting with these couple of hints?
Yes, I feel very comfortable and looking forward for this web seminar.
Okay, cool. Then I think we can actually get right into the content. Today, first of all, we want to get some inputs from your side, what we just discussed. And today we're going to have a red thread through this web seminar. And this is this picture behind you where it says your input is needed. And it simply is self-explanatory. When you see this, be prepared to answer some of our questions. We want to know, first of all, who's on the line today with us. So please, the first question is now posted in the chat as a poll. So let us know where you are dialing in from. We have an afternoon session here now in Europe. So I believe it should be more Europe and, of course, on the America side. But let's see where the people are coming from. Okay, we see quite prominent in Europe, especially Germany. We have a lot of participants. Sweden's popping up. Italy was also up there. Poland, USA, Hungary. It's quite a good spread, I must say, so far. So thank you for that first feedback. And secondly, now that we know where you're dialing in from, we would also like to know what type of company you represent. So please let us know, are you an end user? Are you a machine builder? Perhaps even a sales partner for us? Or do you represent some other type of company that we missed to put up on this selection? Okay, as a start, quite a lot of sales partners, which is of course very nice. Welcome to all of you that we already are in contact with. We have a few machine builders, roughly 20%. Some end users on the line as well, but I'm very interested to get to know who the others are, but let's see if we can find that out later throughout today. Now that we know what type of company you represent, one last question here in the warm-up would be, what function do you have at your company? Are you working in engineering, for example, or sales, prep, production or management, service, purchasing, or even some other departments? Engineering and sales is quite prominent. This would also been our guess before we started this webinar, but this is of course what we want to have on board as well. So very welcome to all the engineers and all the salespeople out there, and of course the rest of you as well. But Halil, I think we now have a pretty good view of who's on the line with us today. So let's start off going deeper into the content and a bit about automation, I would say.
Yes, let's go. I think this will be very exciting for you guys.
What you see here on the picture is still the reality in a lot of places today. You have workers actually palletizing boxes manually. On a daily basis, carrying heavy loads, of course, that will wear them out. If you take the middle part, an operator operating the machine also unloads and loading the machine, and that in the end results that they cannot tend to maybe as many machines as they would like to do, or as you would like them to do. And last but not least, if you have a dispensing application and you do it by hand, you can never reassure that the amount of additives put out on the product is the right amount. So that could lead to quality risks for your product in the long run. These are actually pretty good use cases to think about when it comes to automation, and specifically when it comes to robotics. So I hope we can give you some inspiration throughout today about how perhaps to solve these three use cases. Because by solving that, it could also lead to an improved working environment, increased efficiency, or even increased product quality. So who wouldn't want that? But before we go into details about applications and use cases, we would like to set the stage a little bit about why we are talking about automation and why we are talking about robots. So we pinpoint three different topics why we see the automation with robotics is so important as of today. First of all, it's very tricky nowadays to find qualified labor. And this specific topic is one that is not only a regional topic, it's a worldwide topic. We see this happening everywhere. And of course, a robot that does a job for that previously was done from a manual worker can help solve this problem. The need for the flexible automation. The batch sizes are getting smaller and smaller, and at the same time, the production product variety is getting bigger and bigger. So of course, in the long run, your productivity will actually have to do quite a lot with how quickly you can adjust your production. Last but not least, let's not forget the financial side of things. What we see quite a lot with the collaborative robots is a pretty decent return on invest. So on the looking on the complete solution, what it costs to implement the robots, it's a pretty good payback time. When we're now speaking about robots, collaborative robots, what do we mean? Industrial robots. And to just get a common understanding about what we'll be talking about here the next 30 minutes, we wanted to get a distinguishment between the industrial robots and the cobots. So we just put together on a general level a few points that we think make sense. If we're looking on the industrial robots, most of them are heavy duty and actually have a fixed installation throughout their lifetime. In comparison to the collaborative robots, which are lightweight, that also means they can have a flexible installation. And what do we mean with that? Well, you can have a possibly task change with the robots. So you can redeploy them to do something else. While a industrial robot more is focused on the periodical task over a longer period of time with high repeatability. And what enables this flexibility is the ease of use of the collaborative robots. And especially when we're emphasizing on the teaching and the programming. If you compare that to the programming in an industrial robot, you can spend endless amount of engineering hours to make that up and running. Last but not least, we would like to mention the shared workspace possibilities that you do have on a collaborative robot. And also, you could even have a possible safe human interaction. If you compare that to an industrial robot, we all know that they usually require a separate workspace and they're not so safe to interact with. But please remember that I mentioned possible safe interaction. Just because you're utilizing a cobot does not mean that your complete solution is safe. Halil, did I forget something?
I think that was a very pretty good cover-up of the general idea.
All right. Then I would suggest, let's see how we ended up here and maybe answer the question why we are at Bosch Rexroth headquarters. Some of you, or probably all of you, might know Universal Robots. And a fun fact that not everybody is aware of is actually that Christian Kassow, back in 2005, is one of the three co-founders from Universal Robots. In 2014, Christian Kassow then started the development of a seventh axis cobot, which later became the company of Kassow Robots. If we fast forward a little bit to the year of 2022, this is where Bosch Rexroth became majority stakeholders in Kassow Robots. Hence, we are today in the studio at Bosch Rexroth headquarters. And a lot of has happened since then, with one of our key milestones to relocate to new facilities in Copenhagen, where all of our robots are built. And you've seen the picture already a couple of times with the views from the office. So we make sure the robots are taken good care of before they are shipped out to you in the world. To make a long story short, and to maybe get a little bit better feeling of the robot and the company itself, Halil, could you maybe give some flesh to the bone on our claims, strong, fast, and simple?
Yes, sure. Let's start with the first claim we have, strong. So I will start with the joints. Our joints can hold up to 236 Newton meters, and that's pretty strong, right?
Very strong.
Then we have the second part actually of this strength of our robot, which is the build. It's completely built of aluminum, which ensures actually a robust robot if you have one. Then overall, the high payload and reach ratio of this robot makes this actually, together with a small footprint, to a good fit. Then we have the second claim, fast. Thanks to the seventh joint of our robot, we are pretty flexible in our movements. We can do complex movements easier and reach different locations throughout different movements of the robot, actually. And thanks to the joints as well, again, the joints, we can speed up to 225 degrees per second.
And maybe to give a reference, because that's pretty hard to just say 225 degrees per second. What does that mean? To give a reference, if you have an analog watch, so your second dial, it's moving with 6 degrees per second, just to put it in perspective a little bit.
Yes, I think that's a very good idea to explain. Then we have our last claim, simple. Most of you will be used to smartphones these days, me as well. And the first time when I programmed a Kassow robot, it was very easy for me to get hands on it and understand everything because it's literally an Android app built on it and it's very intuitive to use. And yes, it enables you to program, to simple program, but you're also in good hands when you want to have a complex program as well.
All right, well, actually, I assume these claims are valid for all the five models that we have.
Yes, of course. It's valid for the whole portfolio we offer right now.
All right, well, before we go into the portfolio itself, I would actually like to ask the participants a couple of more questions just to get a feeling of what they are dealing with in their daily business. When we speak about robots and when we speak about automation with robots, there's a few things that are important to know to set the framework, right? And one thing that is very important is, of course, the weight. So if you have an application already done with robots, or if you have something in mind, what would be the typical weight or the average weight you would have to move around in such application? Is it less than 5 kilos, more than 20 kilos, or is there somewhere in between there? Okay, so what we can see from the start is that a lot is in the middle, around 60%, between 5 and 15 kilos. So this is pretty good spread, I would say. There's more and more now coming in also on the lower end side. Quite a few also above 20 kilos, which is pretty interesting to see. Thank you for that answer. A second point, which is very important for us as well, and for all of you when we speak about robots. If you now consider this weight that you just placed as a requirement, how long would you need to move this weight? So how far do you have to move it? Or in other words, which reach would you need to have on your robot? Is it less than a meter? Or is it even more than 1.8 meter, for example? Or once again, is there somewhere in between? Okay, what we can see now from the beginning is quite a lot coming in between 1000 and 1400 millimeters, which is quite expected. This is where we also see a lot of the use cases out there on the market. A little less above 1.8 meter and some there in the higher range between 1.4 and 1.8 meters. So this fits pretty good, I would say, to what we want to show you and discuss with you today. Last but not least, we also want to ask you a question. It doesn't really have to do with the robot itself. It has to do with another type of robot, a mobile robot. So are you considering or have you already implemented some robot arms or cobots on mobile applications, AGVs or AMRs, for example? Okay, quite a lot of people already are planning to or already have done that. So this is very interesting for us to hear as well. Why? I think it will become clear why we asked you these three questions a little bit later through our web seminar here today. But with these three questions answered, I think it's actually time to take a look a little bit about our offering and what we can offer from a Kassow Robot side. The idea of our portfolio is to have actually a portfolio that fits the customer needs and not a one-size-fits-all solutions, which we also sometimes see. But Halil, maybe you can take us through our portfolio and show the participants what we have.
Yes, sure. So our portfolio consists of 5 robots in total. 2 of them are considered small robots, 3 of them are considered big robots. I will start with the small robots. So the first robot in our lineup is the KR810, which has a reach of 850 millimeters and a payload of 10 kilogram, which is actually twice as much as the market standard. Then the second robot in the lineup of the small robots is the KR1205 with a length or reach of 1200 millimeters and a payload of up to 5 kilograms. It comes actually handy if you need that a little bit more reach, but don't have so much space. Then the third robot, which is the first robot of the big ones, is the 1018. The 1018 has a payload of 18 kilograms and a reach of 1 meter. And that's actually our bodybuilder. I mean, we call it so.
All right. Well, it seems that to be a pretty clear logic to the naming of the models if you take the performance into account. So 3 down, 2 to go. Don't let me stop you there. If I say 1410, what do you say?
Well, with 1410, I say 1,400 millimeter reach and 10 kilogram payload. And this is actually a very versatile robot. Then we have the last one, the last of the big ones, and that's the 1805. It has 1,800 millimeters of reach and 5 kilogram payload. And it's actually pretty majestic when you stand next to it.
I would say there's pretty a lot of opportunities out there with this portfolio at hand, right?
Yes, exactly. And it's also worth mentioning, all of our robots come with 7 axes.
As a standard.
As a standard, of course.
And one thing that is not a market standard, which is also important to mention, is that the payloads that Halil just mentioned, you can utilize at the full reach of the robot. Meaning you can take this 5, 10 or 18 kilos all around the working envelope of the robot. So this is important point to also give to you, that you have that in the back of your head.
Yes, exactly. And didn't you say something about mobile applications?
You're right. Now we know about why we asked about payload and reach, but mobile applications, I do think we have some pretty exciting news there as well. Let me introduce to you the Edge Edition. This is in true Kassow Robot spirits, created in a very compact and modular way. We've taken the controller, usually of this size, integrated into the base of the robot itself and standardized it for all our 5 models. With a small footprint of 160 times 200 millimeters only, this is the perfect solution for mobile application. You can easily mount that, of course, on the AGV or an AMR without having an external RC controller there to take up space. Since we're speaking about AGVs or AMRs, Of course, you can connect it directly to the battery of your mobile vehicle. This is a solution that we will bring out to the market here in very short time, and we will open our order books in the end of March. So please reach out for us if you want to be the first to get your hands on an Edge Edition from Kassow Robots series. It is really cool tech, and it is really a cool solution, but independent of how exciting we make our cobots, we still need some peripheral equipment to make a complete solution. And that actually brings us to our next stop. Our next stop is the ecosystem. Recently, we launched a new platform on our Kassow Robots website, where we've listed the products and services for which we have developed a specific software plugin, or in Kassow Robots language, a CBUN. This software driver enables a plug-and-play solution with the robot itself. Our platform is growing on a daily basis, and we are of course happy to extend it with further technology partners. Meaning, if you're one of those potential technology partners, please reach out to us to see how we can make a compatible match with our Kassow robots. Important to also mention is that there are a lot of other compatible products out there. Take, for example, the end of arm tools, which is controlled by a simple I/O or pneumatics. These do not require this CBUN, hence they also don't need that additional space on the platform. So these you can always already use with our Kassow robots, meaning don't let the platform limit us. Now that we know about there is an existing platform and different products around the robot, perhaps you can give us an example of how a complete solution looks when you puzzle these pieces together.
Yes, sure. So we prepared a small image of a cell, including our Kassow robot with some different parts of our ecosystem. So let me start with the Kassow robot itself. As you can see, it's mounted upside down, which means, yes, you can also install the robot upside down. It's installed at an extension column, which can actually lift the robot up and down to extend the reach. Then the second part is the camera system. The camera system actually enables the robot to know where to pick. Then we have the gripper. The gripper enables the robot to pick. And then we have the PLC. The PLC actually, despite our big variety of IOs on the controller itself, enables the robot for extended machine communication. And then last but not least, we have like this simulation software, which enables you to see what your cycle time is and if this whole constellation works as you intended before you started in real world. And to add one more possibility, actually, our CBUNs extend further with CBUNX. You can create your own applications and extend them as well with this new platform.
All right. Well, thank you for running us through that example. And I think that paints a pretty good picture about how you can utilize these different products and services on the platform and build a complete solution. And I really like the idea with the CBUNX framework, where you give the opportunity to not only the technology partners, but also to normal partners or our end users to build their own application blocks within the system. So thank you for taking us through that. But I would say enough theory for now. I think it's time to go into a little bit more action. We promised you hands-on before, so we got a little surprise for you prepared here in the studio. What do you say, Hailil? Should we go over?
Yeah, let's go there.
Okay, let's take a walk. So here we are with our Kassow robot KR810.
Exactly. This is the smallest robot of the lineup. And yeah, it can lift up to 10 kilograms, as I said.
Okay. And is there something we can show the participants to really display the benefits of having a seventh axis robot?
Yes, for sure. We can actually demonstrate our elbow.
Okay.
So can you please, do you have a phone with you? Can you please
I
put
do.
It here?
My phone? Okay.
Yes. You just place it on the robot itself.
Are you sure? Do you know what you're doing?
I know what I'm doing.
Well, I got a couple of calls to make this afternoon.
And as you can see, we can change the position of the elbow as we wish. Move it back again.
So we're rotating around the body, keeping the tool head still.
Exactly. That's what we can do thanks to the 7th axis.
That is pretty impressive, I must say. But can I please have my phone back now?
Yes, for sure.
Thank you for that. I mean, that is a pretty impressive feature. And we've been talking a lot about ease of use, so perhaps we can display something about that as well. What do you think? Could we even try to make a quick program here on the fly?
Yes, for sure.
All right. Let me
quickly prepare everything for you. So, now we can start.
Okay, what do we do first?
First, the gripper. We brought a gripper from our ecosystem, and it comes with a quick changer. So, what we can do is simply put it in, and it's ready to use. We just have to activate the software plugin. Yeah, and that's it.
Okay, can you please show us how to do that?
Yeah, if we can share the screen. Now you see the tablet screen I'm currently working on. And to activate the CBAN plugin, what we have to do is we have to select Linus. Yes, exactly, perfect. We have to select the gripper. This red one, you can see it there on the back next to Linus. And then all we have to do is press activate. Then the system is activating the gripper itself and initializing. Then we have to mount it so the weight and the TCP is set correctly.
Okay, so meaning all the data that the gripper carries is now activated so the robot controller knows about it just through the CBAN.
Yes, exactly. That's exactly. That's how it works.
Seems pretty easy to me.
Yes, it is. Then let's go a further part or further step actually and make a small pick and place solution.
Let's do it.
Okay, to do that, the first thing I'm going to do is drag and drop a move command to our program tree.
And just like that.
That's how you make a move command.
Okay.
Then I take the tablet, put it on side, and now it comes to the handy part with our hands. So,
how do you teach it?
We have a button over here.
So you don't need the teach pendant.
You don't need the teach pendant. That's correct. You have a button over here, and with this button, you can move the robot to a certain position you wish. For example, this position.
Okay, and I believe that's pretty handy if you have larger robots you gotta move around. You have two hands instead of just one.
Yes, exactly. You can just touch the robot with both hands and the one is supporting and the other one is doing the work. With a simple double click now, I can teach that position. Right now, it's called P2.
Okay.
So with this position P2, we can now move on to another position. Let's say here. What do you say? Is it good?
I have no idea what you're doing, so I'm
should be interested. Okay. Let's do a double click. And as you see, it just creates a second move command.
So it automatically creates a move command and automatically creates a new position.
Yes.
But why is it then red? Did we do something wrong?
Yes, it's red because it's not confirmed yet. Because the first one was intended, but the second one may be not intended. Okay. So the program automatically says that this might be not intended and we have to confirm
feature.
It. Yes, exactly. To not mess up with the future program.
Good to know.
Then let's make a third position. How about this?
You tell me.
Looks good.
All right, if you say so.
Okay, now after we teach our three positions, I will confirm them. Confirm, and now they're there. Now they're ready to work
with. Are we ready with the program?
Not yet.
Not yet?
Now we have to do small adjustments. Now I will drag and drop the gripper itself into the program.
So this is the CBAN that then was activated.
Yes, exactly. Then I can select here force with which the gripper will close. And then I will multiply, I will multiply the P2 and put it under the gripper.
Okay.
So we actually have the full program ready.
Really? That's
yes,
it?
That's it.
Okay. Can we press play and see what happens?
Yes. Let's see what happens. I hope I did everything correct. Let's see. Now the program is loading.
And that depends then on the loading time, depends on the size of the program?
Yes, exactly. It always depends on the size and different factors.
Okay.
And the first move is always the first joint position.
And you get a confirmation when you're there, right?
Yes, exactly. And let's go. Mm-hmm. That's it.
Karaoke time?
If you want.
I hope not. But I'll keep it for later.
Yes, here you are.
Thank you very much. And that's how easy you actually can make a pick and place program. So just within a couple of minutes, we actually made a program here on the fly doing a simulated pick and place motion.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, well, that's pretty cool. So we've seen how we can keep the tool head still and move around our own body more or less. We've seen how easy it is to make a program and how simple it is to use. What else is there that you can show us that this robot is differentiating itself compared to the rest of the market?
Yeah, let me quickly show you something.
Okay, what do you got installed for us?
Are you ready?
I'm ready, are you?
Let's go. Now I show you something where we can full use the seventh axis by getting somewhere where you usually couldn't get to.
So we can actually go in and underneath objects, for example, or even avoid them if that would be necessary.
Yes, exactly. That's thanks to the seventh axis.
That is really impressive. I guess it's almost time for coffee, so I'll save it for later. Thank you very much for that.
You're welcome.
All right, so pretty impressive. Keep moving around our own body. We can have a very easy and intuitive programming. And we can also move around and in and beneath and under and above objects.
Yes.
All right. With this new knowledge that we have, perhaps we should go back to where we started. What do you say?
Yeah, let's go.
Okay, let's see. With the newly acquired knowledge that we do have, perhaps we should jump in to the applications where we actually discussed in the beginning of the day. I mean, you recognize these pictures, right?
Yeah.
We had the manual guy doing the palletizing, where the operator loading and unloading the machine, and somebody doing dispensing by hand. But I do think these are pretty good examples. As we said in the beginning, what we can solve with our robots, and I think maybe you can give us some insight about how they can be solved to inspire the people online.
Yes, sure. Let's start with the first one. And the first one you talked about was the palletizing. And in this video, you can see our robot within the palletizing cell. And thanks to the seventh axis, we can just move within the cell. So we make sure the elbow always stays in the cell. This is first important for the employees that work next to it, so they are secure. And second, of course, for the machines next to it. So it can be way narrower, everything can be smaller because the robot is more flexible and has a smaller footprint in total.
All right, so what you're saying is that there's a lot of also hidden benefits that you might not know about when you're first selecting which robot you want to automate with.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, interesting to hear. And what about the second picture we see? Machine tending, machine loading, unloading? Do you got something for us there as well?
Yes, so in machine tending solutions, you usually have to retrofit a robot in an existing machine. And in this case, the advantage of the 7-axis robot is it can stand next to the door, because with the elbow it can just touch into the door when it stays next to it. And this is a benefit a 6-axis robot doesn't have, because it has to stand in front of the door to actually reach everything. Then comes also the second benefit of this particular user case, and this is, for example, when there's maintenance work on the tending machine, the robot doesn't have to be removed, because you can simply press the button, move the robot away, and you're good to go.
Okay, so to summarize that, sounds like we can save a lot of time and of course also space just by placing the robot on the side instead of in the middle of the machine, door opening, so to say.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, very good. We learn something new every day. And last but not least, do you got an ace up your sleeve for the dispensing as well?
Yes, so for the dispensing, we also have a video prepared. And here you can see, like, there are a few important things in the dispensing part. So first of all, we need a constant tooltip speed, what we can provide you with. And in addition to that, our robot can run, thanks to the seventh axis again, a very complex trajectory in one go. And this is for some gluing applications, for example, important, where everything has to go in one go or one run. And this is something we can provide with our robot. And yeah, total, the seventh axis makes the robot more flexible. And what else should I say? I mean, that's impressive, right?
I think that's plenty of benefit. So We saw now three different use cases and a lot of different benefits of automating with the Kassow robots, right?
Yes.
But this is, of course, not all that is possible. So if there are, if you're interested in more use cases, we would strongly suggest that you go and visit our Kassow Robots website, because there you'll find not only use cases, but if you have a specific application, you'll also find contacts to your sales partners and to the technology partners if you're interested in specific solutions that we have available on our platform, ecosystem platform. But I think before we will coming to an end closely in the session, we have a couple of more questions to ask you guys on the line. I believe you know what this picture now means. So I would say, let's just put the two questions out there in the chat and we will keep giving you some additional information. We just mentioned the website, and one actually very good thing about that is you can find out which shows we will be attending and where we will be present here in the coming future. And of course, we would be very happy if you come by to just get a demo of the robot, get a feeling of it, and have some discussions with us. That we would really be looking forward to. And we posted some questions in the chat, but I also have to ask you, Halil, how satisfied were you with this webinar?
I'm very satisfied with the webinar, and it was a pleasure to be able to present the robot to you guys, some applications, and yeah, our seventh axis.
Very good. Thank you for spending the time here with us. And with that, it's actually time for us to say goodbye. But first of all, thank you for calling in and participating in today's web seminar session. We hope to see you and hear from you soon. All the best and have a good day.
Have a good day. Bye.